Welcome to Center Stage once again. I'm Mark Gordon, and we're going to talk about film tonight. Tonight, the film is The Russian Woodpecker, and we have the director, Chad Gracia, and Fedora Alexandrovich. How did you find this story?
You know, it's a strange tale. I had never made a film before, a documentary or any other kind of film. I was doing a play. I was producing a play in Kiev, and Fyodor was our set designer. And every time there would be a break in our rehearsal, he would pull me aside and say, "Chad, this play is kind of boring. You got to check out this Russian woodpecker that I discovered." And he kept nagging me for weeks and weeks. Finally, I agreed. I thought he wanted me to go to a zoo or an aviary. Eventually, I discovered that the Russian woodpecker was a secret Soviet signal that sort of irradiated the Western world during the Cold War. And I thought, well, why not? I'll do a little 5-minute piece on this. We'll put it up on YouTube and sort of close the book on what this tapping was, this Russian woodpecker. But as soon as we started, it was like falling down the rabbit hole. And it took a long time to get out of that hole. And the film eventually grew to be a feature length and brought us to where we are now. Fyodor's an artist. He's an eccentric, inspired, and it's important to say irradiated artist. He was 4 years old when Chernobyl happened, and that left a big imprint on him. And I think he spent much of his life trying to understand that catastrophe and trying to understand how it could have happened. And so when we did our initial research into the signal, we found that it was coming from just a few kilometers from the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. And Fyodor had a hunch as an artist that they were somehow connected. So that was the beginning of our investigation.
How long did you spend looking at the Russian woodpecker and coming up with this, with kind of a thesis that some would say that's very conspiratorial?
That Russian woodpecker, for me, it's in first metaphor of Iron Curtain. That is very long, very tall iron wall between the normal and unnormal world, the open world and closed post-Soviet world. That is Iron Curtain. And for me, in the first, that is poetic metaphor and poetic film. That is film much and film with symbol of journey to Dark Tower. That is, Dark Tower is as Iron Curtain, as wall between normal world and world of White Walker, the post-Sovietic world.
It's important, quickly I'll butt in and say that the Russian woodpecker tapping, it soon became clear that it was coming from an enormous steel antenna, one of the largest ever constructed. It cost billions of dollars at the time, and it was state-of-the-art, and it still stands because it's in the radioactive zone. And this is the Iron Curtain that Fyodor is referring to. It's a monolith. It's an insane Soviet structure.
So, Chad, did you actually go into Chernobyl as well? I mean, because...
Yeah, we did. We took our crew there.
So how did... Were you all suited up and all that? Because... Fedor's very, he's kind of loosely costumed to go into this area,
well,
throwing caution to the wind, I guess.
Yeah, we weren't really suited up. I mean, we had a guide who, you know, in Ukraine, things are done a little bit differently.
You drink a lot of vodka. I hear that's supposed to help, right?
You know, it's actually red wine that the government told everyone would protect them against radiation. So there was a lot of red wine drunk after the catastrophe. Of course, it doesn't help.
Yeah, there's
all.
A lot of imbibing in the film with all the subjects.
Yeah, that we've been asked about that a few times. That was not, that was not planned. That's just sort of what we captured.
So
we took some precautions. We followed some basic rules, but the biggest precaution was to get in and out as quickly as possible.
Because what are the radiation levels there now?
They vary. Most of the radiation was in the dust, and it settled to the ground. And as long as you don't go off these cement paths, you're only about 5 to 10 times normal. But if you go off the path and you start kicking up this dust, you can create a little mini radioactive cloud that's quite dangerous.
There's a couple of things that are brought up in the film. One is genocide and the other is World War III. Tell me about these concepts with the film.
We began this as a very sort of an artistic exploration of this antenna. We had no idea that it would lead to uncovering what could have been the biggest crime of the 20th century, of the Soviet Union, at least, in Fyodor's eyes. That's what he discovered. And that happened because we started to interview the people who built this antenna, and they were clearly lying to us. And they were clearly sort of sending us signals to throw us off the scent. So what started as a sort of an artistic symbolic exploration became a real investigation, and it got scarier and more dangerous the more we dug into it. It's you know, for me, it was very hard to believe that there could be such a conspiracy, that there could be, that it could be real, that someone could have purposely blown up Chernobyl in a way that that was related to this antenna. It's quite a long theory. You'd have to see the film to sort of see how all the pieces are put together by Fyodor. But I was very skeptical. But the more that we researched and the more that we talked with people who led the investigation into the Chernobyl accident, the most senior people, the head of the Soviet Union's investigatory committee, the head of the Ukrainian investigation committee, they both looked me in the eye and said, "You're being naive. You're a naive American. There's a cover-up here. We know that the documents were falsified. We know that the call the night of the explosion, that those transcripts have been not only redacted, just they've been cut up, and they're all out of order. And there's something fishy is being hidden. They're locked away in the archives in Moscow." So Fyodor took that and tried to piece together what could be in those archives, what could be hidden, what would make sense, what could be a motive. And he thinks that he found the person who was responsible for the Chernobyl catastrophe, and that it's inextricably linked to this massive secret Soviet radar that stands right in the shadow of the power plant.
There's also this this notion of history repeating itself, where now the Soviet Union, they want to come back, and it's almost a sense of global domination again.
Yeah,
and
I mean,
repression and the all the things that come with it.
I think the possible height of return Soviet Union is possible as people not understand
Who's to blame? Who's to blame for the Soviet Union?
Who is blame of Soviet Union? That is, when have a honor, it's, oh, very good, Soviet Union, Stalin, have victory to the Hitler, save the world of the fascism. And that is, as say the Winston Churchill, the new fascism begin as anti-fascism. And now we have the new fascism and have the very big dangerous for all world, but have the Russia have nuclear bomb, and that is the red bottom is in one man, and that is one man have the dream, have the fantasy, have the sleep maybe, and we don't knew what is the world, that is irreal world, what is leadership of Russia, and the old people in Russia exist in the totalitarian sector. The fascism is totalitarianism. Totalitarian sect, как Jim Jones.
Like a totalitarian cult?
Totalitarian cult, yes. That is, the fascism is totalitarian cult of leader, of idea. And now we are all in dangerous, in all world in dangerous in this moment. And that is the return, the ghost of communism, but with another name, another face. But that is the ghost of unforgivity, and not understanding self-history.
Fedora, at one point you realize that your life may be in danger.
After a year of following his investigation, one day he stopped returning our phone calls. He said, "Everything I said was wrong. I made a mistake. And I want to destroy the film." We were trying to get to the bottom of what happened. Why is Fyodor, what happened to him? Why is he, who spooked him? And we couldn't figure it out. Finally, Artyom, our cameraman, said, "Look, let's try, I'll go there with a secret camera and we'll film him, we'll talk to him." And I said, "Well, you know, Fyodor's a friend. I feel kind of bad about that." Artyom said, no, don't worry. He's been filming you with a secret camera for the last few weeks anyway.
Oh, seriously?
Oh, he thought, we discovered later that the secret police had come to Fyodor and said, stop immediately your investigation.
What is that experience like? Did they just knock at your door and they show unannounced? They call you or do they bug your home? I mean, what is that experience like?
I meeting with the officer of secret police. That is maybe 1 hour after the interview with the head of Ukrainian commission. And I understand the situation that is very dangerous situation. And these people who connected with this crime, with Chernobyl catastrophe, that who is calling, that is do knew about us, that I have this tape with the
all of our interviews. Yeah, they thought that we actually had some original copies of the transcript of that evening. We didn't get a hold of those, but Fyodor is saying that they thought that we had those.
They think that is we have not that is not version, but we have a proof, but that we have this tape. And when I do understand that they will found this tape and think that as I have this tape in my room, in my apartment, maybe, I understand that as I and my family is in very big danger. But that is before this film to be made. After, when we speak about this, now that is dangerous is not so big, but this dangerous exists as when you not fight this ghost of communism in Ukraine, and that is a ghost in the each person who is in power. So,
what was the response? Have you shown it in Ukraine, the film?
Yes, we had.
And what was the response like?
Very positive. I was surprised, really, because I thought, well, you know, these Ukrainians lived through all of these horrors of the Soviet Union and Chernobyl and the revolution, all of which our film deals with and touches on. And I thought, why would they want to hear from a Western, you know, an American director telling the story through an artist's eyes? Like, I just thought it would be that it would either be old news to them or that they would feel that it should be told by Ukrainians exclusively. But on the contrary, they embraced the film. People have been extremely, extremely grateful and fascinated. And everyone, you know, for us, I'm still skeptical that Fyodor has been able to put together the puzzle pieces exactly right. I mean, for me, the film is more of a psychological exploration into the mind of one man who was irradiated as a child and who's trying to come to terms with that. And it's a exploration of a society that's been traumatized for 100 years of lies and totalitarianism and authoritarianism, as Fyodor constantly says.
Fyodor, have you come to terms with it, or are you still searching for a reason?
Ти думаєш, що ти знайшов, що ти хотів?
I believe, but I not will the found the reason of Chernobyl catastrophe. I will explain that is have not conspiracy theory. And we will in film show that is have not conspiracy theory. That is the very all is very simple. And when we investigation, we found the absolute that is not absolute conspiracy, absolute logic theory. And we this found. I not will found this information. That is dangerous information. But I found maybe that is time of this information. That is not I found this information, but information will open this mystery for world. That is Alfred Hitchcock says that is in the future film the director is God, in the documentary film of the God is director. And now we have a God of director, and when we found this information, I am absolute shocking. It's impossible. It's so evil. It's I am not believe. We must found the proof that is I have the mistake. But not. I have not mistake. We found the another proof.
It's true. It's crazy. Yeah. The story's crazy. So. The idea is crazy. But the more people we talk to, they looked us in the eye. Not low level people. We're talking about very senior officials, who said, "Yeah, you got it. You're on the right track. Be careful."
Now that the film is out, is the danger level higher?
Right after the secret police came and threatened Fyodor, not long after the pro-Russian government fell, and in Ukraine there's several different warring factions in the secret police, and the pro-Russian faction lost power, and all those guys have either changed their pins, now they're all pro-Euro, pro-European Union, and they've probably cut their ties back to the Kremlin. So the immediate threat that Fyodor was facing, and some of the things that he did in the film that would have landed him in jail if the previous government had not been had not fled the country. But luckily, there was a new start right after we stopped filming. There's now a pro-European government, and so that danger has passed. We've been invited to Moscow to show the film in December, and Fyodor is quite terrified about going to Moscow. And again, when he talks about it, my initial reaction is, you're overreacting. Come on, it's a film festival. But there's a filmmaker. His name is Oleg Sentsov. He's Ukrainian. He was picked up by Russian troops and sentenced to 20 years in prison in a total mockery of a trial. So he's in prison. So Fyodor's ideas, Fyodor, long before anyone else was talking about this, Fyodor was saying the Soviet Union is coming back. The war is coming, and no one thought that he was speaking sense. So I've learned not to doubt him, and so probably, as he said, he'll be in Moscow in spirit on the screen, but his body will be back safe in Kiev.
Do you think it's also too because as an American, we haven't really experienced this. We haven't really experienced any kind of revolution or fascist governments or secret police invading homes?
Yeah, no, we don't live in a perfect society. And, I'm constantly telling my Russian and Ukrainian friends that, this America is not paradise on earth, and we have lots and lots of big problems. But we generally don't have, journalists don't get bullets in the back of their head the moment they start researching a rich person's business ties. People don't, they don't just disappear, or they don't get, they don't get put through show trials. And so it's impossible nor have millions of Americans died on our land. I mean, Ukraine, there's a great book called The Bloodlands, which in one word really captures what Ukraine has been for hundreds of years. So the amount of suffering and trauma and the number of ghosts there, it was really hard for me as an American to understand. At first I thought, this Cold War, the Soviet Union, this is all ancient history. But as we went forward with our film, I started to see that these ghosts were alive, they're powerful, they're dangerous, and they still exist. It's not a Russian versus Ukraine thing. To me, it's more of a Soviet mindset versus a modern, open, free mindset. A lot of the people that we met that were fighting against us were Ukrainians, but they were Soviet. They were Soviet people. They're people that still operated through intimidation and lies and through fear. All they had to do was hint that Fyodor's son was not safe. He has an 8-year-old son, and that was enough to destroy our project.
What about the, were you there at Ground Zero? Because there are scenes where there are riots and uprising. Were you there filming that?
Totally randomly. About halfway through, I figured, you know what? It looks like this is going to be longer than 5 minutes. I might as well get myself a camera and learn how to shoot. So I went back to Ukraine. I went into one of the peaceful protests, and I was just looking around. Then a stun grenade went off right next to me. It knocked me off my feet. I landed into a crowd. There were about 50,000 people there. And I landed right next to Fyodor, who happened to be in the same space. I didn't even know he was in the country. I immediately plucked off the lens cap and started shooting. And Fyodor, I said, "What's happening?" And Fyodor has this very powerful, impassioned speech. And the bombs were going off around us. and Molotov cocktails. And that's the opening scene of the film. And that's the only scene that I filmed. The rest of the movie was filmed by the brilliant Artyom Ryzhikov, who was a friend of Fyodor's, who Fyodor brought on board very early. I had no idea who this guy was, and I thought it was going to be a big hassle. But when I started to see the material that he was able to capture, and he's such a visionary, and he's so courageous. So the film really is a testament to his bravery and his eye. So after that first night, I pulled all of the team far away from the front lines. But Artyom refused. He said, I want to go back, and I want to record
this. He was injured
too,
right? Was he the one that was injured?
Yeah, he went back to record this for posterity, and he picked up his camera. He started shooting, and a sniper shot a bullet right into the lens of his camera. It saved his life. His camera exploded, but it would have gone into his head. The second bullet hit his bicep, knocked him to the ground. And then the next two shots killed the people to the left and right of him.
That's a very, very raw scene when he talks to the camera about what had happened.
Yeah, well, he disappeared. And then, you know, at that time, this film was funded just by credit cards and borrowed funds. So we were out of money. But I knew I had to get Artyom to a doctor. And in Ukraine at that time, anyone who went to the hospital with any injuries, that was a sign that you were part of the protests.
So they reported?
No, they stripped them and threw them into the forest where they would be found the next day frozen to death. No, or they beat them with bats until they were senseless. To be reported would have been wonderful. No, so Artyom walked as long and far as he could. He found a veterinarian who took out the bullet from his arm. And then when he got to an internet cafe about 4 days later, he called me and I said, "Look, we're going to get you some money. We're going to get you to a doctor. We're going to take care of you." And I said, "Can you just please tell me what happened?" So then he recorded and we put it on Indiegogo, and within an hour we had, from all over the world, from strangers, we had all the money that we needed to get him and to get him to surgery and to get him rehabilitated, and also to get him a new camera, because it took him years to save for that. And that interview is in the film that he did with this Skype, very low quality, but the emotions are really
maybe low quality but high content.
Yeah.
What was the biggest challenge for you, Chad, making the Russian Woodpecker?
Honestly, the biggest challenge for me was editing, because we had five seemingly unrelated stories. We had the story of the history of Ukraine. We had the story of this antenna, the Russian woodpecker, and the technology behind it. We had the story of Fyodor's investigation. We had the story of the Maidan, Euromaidan revolution. And then we had the story of Fyodor's dream investigation. I didn't touch on this. Fyodor refused to do a traditional investigation unless we also reenacted his dreams. And his first dream, he said to me, was, "Chad, I must build a raft out of mirrors and sail it across a radioactive sea, naked, with a torch. And that is how we will find the truth, if we can bring back my dreams and my nightmares."
He's Oedipus.
He's many things, but
that's why. Because
he's a madman. But
the film does have kind of a really surreal quality to it. There are these vignettes that are very surreal, where he has a kind of a clear mask.
Yeah, that's his. Those are his dreams,
and it's almost like he's doing Otello or or Life of Pi meets something.
Yeah,
I didn't ask.
Andy Warhol.
That is the first we're speaking with Chad, who is a protagonist, who is antagonist, and maybe the protagonist is I, and antagonist is I too. But the antagonist is ghost of communism. And if you will fight the ghost, you must come to dream. Yeah, that is only in dream you have victory and found victory of the ghost. And the Shamshin is ghost. He's dead now. And death, yes?
He's
and,
dead.
That. And when the ghost is enemy, must fighting with ghost in dream. And that is dream about fighting, about journey to truth.
Fyodor's very poetic when he says, and there's some truth maybe, that ghosts must be battled in dreams. But I come from this from as a producer, and it's very difficult to film these kinds of battles. But we found some way to do it. And to answer your question about what was most difficult, it was finding the through line. And for me, it was a eureka moment when I realized that the only story I wanted to tell was the story of Fyodor's evolution, the journey of his soul, from this four-year-old irradiated child to a man who eventually stood up to these ghosts, which we see at the end.
Well, gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us this evening to talk about The Russian Woodpecker. We've been talking with Chad Garcia and Fyodor Alexandrovich. And just a reminder, you can listen to Center Stage every Tuesday night from 7 to 8 on KXLU Los Angeles. We're also streaming at KXLU.com. Thank you, gentlemen.